Hello everyone, welcome to this new video. Now, last time we talked about normalization of the wave function, at least from a more theoretical point of view. Now we're going to go into a first example, and on the next video we'll do a second example. And for now, we haven't really begun talking about how exactly we get these wave functions. I mean, we said, yeah, sure, they pop up when we solve the Schrödinger equation, and we will solve the equation and get wave functions. But first, we have to make sure that we have all of the tools that we need in order to not only solve the equation, but also actually be able to do something with the wave function that we get. So first, we are going to have to work with some somewhat abstract wave functions. You might ask yourself, like, where does this come from? What does this mean? And for now, this is mainly just to practice some of the important tools that we need to have before we can actually do real work. So in this first example, we have a particle of mass m, which is described as some time t by the non-normalized wave function. Oh, there's a typo there, which is this right here. The psi of x is a e times minus small a times the absolute value of x, where a is just some positive number. Now, the first we are asked to do here is to determine the normalization constant a. And then we have to determine the length L of the interval centered at the origin, which basically means from minus L to L, in which the probability of finding the particle is 0.4. This is just an application of this whole normalization thing, and a little bit of this Born statistical interpretation. So let's begin by normalizing. As we said, in order to normalize, we just have to take this probability, which is psi of x comma t. In this case, there is no time dependence here, so we can just write psi of x, and we'll see that this is always going to be the case here, dx. So what is our psi in this case? In this example, it's written as phi, but it's the same, it doesn't really matter. So it goes from minus infinity to infinity. So remember, this is just the conjugate of psi times psi, but in this case the wave function is real, so the conjugate is going to be the same as the non-conjugate wave function. So this is just going to be a e to the minus a absolute value of x times a e to the minus a absolute value of x dx. So now we just multiply that and we get a squared, which we can just take out of the integral, times e to the minus 2a absolute value of x dx. So now we have this integral, which I hope you know how to solve. This is one that is relatively common. If you don't know, don't worry, we will solve it anyways. So what we have to do here is we have to realize that this function here is even. So that means, for example, because let's think of another even function. So let's just think about the absolute value of x. So the absolute value of x is something like that. And it's the same at both sides. And if we take the integral to be the area under the curve, the total area, well, in this case, it's divergent, I think, well, whatever. But the whole point is, if we take it to be the area under this curve, the total area is just going to be twice the area of one side, because it's exactly mirrored with respect to the y-axis. So the whole point of doing that is we can now rewrite this integral as a squared integral from 0 to infinity. So we basically just take one side, but we have to multiply it by 2. So we get 2a squared the integral from 0 to infinity. This is exactly the same. And now we can drop this absolute value sign. And that's why we did this. We needed to get rid of the absolute value sign. So now we can just perform this integral. So now, well, we just integrate. This is a relatively standard function. So here we get e to the minus 2ax divided by minus 2a. And this whole thing is evaluated between 0 and infinity. So when we evaluate at infinity, this term is just going to be 0. So we get 2 big A squared times, well, the first term is 0 minus the second term, but there is also a minus down here, so it just becomes positive. And this exponential evaluated at 0 is just going to be 1, so we get 1 over 2a. So this is just going to be, the 2 cancels out, and we get a squared over a. So this is this integral, and in order to normalize it, we need this to be equal to 1. So now from here we can find that the normalization constant big A is just the square root of this number a. Great. So this is part A. Now we found the normalization constant. This process is honestly pretty straightforward. If the wave function is complicated, it might be a bit more hard or harder to integrate, but the idea is pretty simple, as you can see. And we will see a different case in the next video, but for now, that is about it. And then we are asked to determine the length of this interval centered at the origin, such as it has the probability of finding the particle at 0.4. So what does this mean? Remember, this says the probability of finding the particle from minus infinity to infinity is 1. So now we want to find the interval centered at the origin. So that means we need to integrate the probability from minus L to L. Okay? Of this probability, so this is just of psi squared dx. But we already know this psi squared. So this is minus L to L. And if I remember correctly, this is just a squared e to the minus 2a absolute value of x. But we also know a squared, so we can also replace that. And we get small a e to the minus 2a x. Oh, I missed the x here. Okay. So now this has to be equal to 0.4 because we want to find the length of the interval such that this is 0.4, okay? So now we just solve this integral similar to last time. This is an even function, so we can write it as 2 times the integral from 0 to L times a minus 2a x without the absolute value sign. And now we can just perform this integral. We take this a out first, 2a, and now we integrate this, and we get, similar to last time, e to the minus 2a x divided by minus 2a from 0 to L. And well, now we have to evaluate this. And let's see, what do we get here? So this is just going to be 2a times e to the minus 2al divided by minus 2a minus, now evaluated at 0, so we get 1 over minus 2a. Okay, so now we simplify this. We will have this first term, which is just going to, this 2a will cancel out this 2a down here. So we get e to the minus 2al with a negative sign in front. This negative sign will now be positive. So we get just 1. And this has to be equal to 0.4, as we saw. That's our condition. We want it to be equal to 4. Okay, just like to check, if you take here that this interval has to be of infinite length, and then you would get that this probability would have to be 1 for this to make sense, which is kind of what we already knew because that's what we did last time. This is basically the same thing, but this time our interval can have any length. But we want to find the interval such that the probability is 0.4. So now we can just take all the numbers to one side, this exponential to the other. So we get 0.6 is equal to e to the minus 2al. Now we just take the natural log of both sides. So log of 0.6 is equal to the natural log of e to the minus 2al. Now this right hand side is just going to be minus 2al. Times the log of e, which is just 1. And from here we can find that L is just going to be the log of 0.6 negative divided by 2a. So this is going to be the length. Now, if we knew a, we could find exactly what this length is, but because it's just some random number, we can't really find it. But this is the answer. And if you just plug some number in for a, you're going to find this length such that the probability of finding the particle there is 0.4. So as you see, this process is pretty straightforward. You just need to know this equation right here, which is this whole probability equation. So you have to know that if you integrate this probability in a certain interval, you're going to find what is the probability of finding the particle there. So that is it for this video. I will see you in the next one where we do another example of this. Thank you very much.